Headed home now, with a long commute. Traffic's going to be terrible, I'm sure. Long work week. And we're looking at addiction. And I can say this, that all addiction are just branches from one tree. And what is that tree? Valuing time. The tree of valuing time. That is where all addictions come from. So the best way I find to knock out addictions, overcome addictions, is to start paying attention to the issue of valuing time. And this is called the spiritual path. Because this will interest us so much. So we say, huh, you mean I can get free of all of them? Yeah. So this is very motivational. Part of the problem with getting free of addictions is you think, well, yeah, I get rid of this one, but I got these other ones, or there'll be more. Why should I even try? What's the use? Right? But when we find out that all addictions have a common root, a common trunk, part of a common tree of valuing time, then that gives us a different sense of motivation, doesn't it? And say, wow, maybe I can get uproot that tree. Of course, I better not say that. I'm in Palo Alto, and I'd probably be arrested for a hate speech for saying uproot the tree. I was just talking metaphorically. Wow, what are you talking about? You know, we heard you say uproot a tree. I said, no, I wouldn't do that. Believe me. I was talking about the metaphorically the tree of valuing time and all the addictions that tree, you know, gives root. I better not say that. Quiet. Speak quietly here. They go through Palo Alto. They protect trees here. With armed vigilantes. Oh, I gotta watch my tongue. Watch my tongue, don't I? It's terrible here. I mean, look at the PC police we have in our heads, right? Like self-censorship. You can't. Oh, there's a little self-driving car. The little tiny little pillbox. Okay. Have a snowy egret on the side or something like that, or a blue heron, I don't know, it looks like a heron. Headed back to the barn. So, to overcome our addictions, we need to turn our attention to spiritual literacy and say, there's something I can do, I can focus on, that is going to really give me more than any of the addictions will give me. Addictions are just to try to forget how miserable we are in our search, of our futile search. But if we can drop the futile search altogether, then certainly all misery is going to go. And this is what we are told, is that at some point on the path, you reach a situation where misery is gone. It's gone. Not even leaving a trace. So it's always worth reminding ourselves of this. As we start moving towards the teeth of the commute here. Well, Friday, you just say, okay, let's just take it, get the rest for 2 days, and then back to the stressful grind. You know, a lot of people now, they don't, it's not one dog, it's two or three, actually. They're walking. Really. They figure the more dogs, the better. It's a three-dog world. Three-dog night. We're in a three-dog night, for sure. Easy to be kind or something like that. I keep hearing this song. I don't know if I can get through here. I can get through here. Yes, I can. Wow, that was a nice maneuver. I decided to squeeze past these cars that were stuck there. I'm on the road to we're on the road to Shambhala. I keep walking into stores and it's playing. I said, what? I mean, that song is on the playlist of somehow it's gotten on the store playlist. All sorts of different stores. I'm hearing that in the grocery store, the hardware store, right? Everybody's happy, everybody's kind. We're on the road to Shambhala. Ooh, that was Three Dog Night, I believe. Or was it Steppenwolf? Now I'm confused. But that's a good sign, isn't it? We're on the road to Shambhala. The headquarters of the hierarchy, the mythical paradise realm, different dimension. That's why we can't find it. We have troubles finding Shambhala. It's in another dimension. Well, we should be able to visit there at least. So maybe we should try to visit Shambhala tonight. In our dreams, we'll go to Shambhala. I think I'll do that. Make a note. Visit Shambhala. Here, get the phone out. I'll make a voice note. Tonight, make sure I remember to visit Shambhala. Why not? Get a guide? Have a guru take me there? One of my guru friends take me to Shambhala and experience it and meet some of the, you know, just start getting familiar with Shambhala. So, we need to do the things that ascension requires. So whatever ascension requires, this is what our attention, our play of attention needs to be focused on here. So I'm, again, saw a house be demolished today. No doubt tearing out the foundation to everything. Everything must go. Not so exciting, actually. That's interesting, right? It's like, you know, I don't really have to sit around and watch the house be demolished. It's not really that exciting. I didn't get to see the implosion of the walls and stuff. I think I've seen that once before, kind of. But this was like down to the foundation, ripping the concrete and rebar out. And of course, this world's like slated, I believe, to go through a remodeling structurally. They don't like the mountains. It interferes with their cell signals, you see. So you can't really have a fourth-dimensional world in a super mountainous, valley-ish terrain. They want a smooth, cue ball type of world, a fourth-dimensional. That's what they love. And so all the wireless stuff just zips around all, you know, easy. Cable, everything. This mountains is driving them nuts here. So there is a remodeling schedule to take place in this world, actually. It's what I've seen, taken into the future and saw what's going to happen to this world, and it ends up smooth as a cue ball. I got the cell towers there, and just all unobstructed. Everybody's got signals. See, nobody left behind. I mean, what about the mountain folk, the hillbillies? Really? I mean, no hillbillies. There's no hills. They don't like hillbillies. They want everybody to be connected. You never know what them hillbillies going to be thinking about out there, because they ain't connected to the grid. They might have some strange ideas. Might have been talking to God. And we can't have this. We got to have everybody, on Facebook. We got everybody Facebooking or doing something like that. Everybody hooked in. Everybody's into the grid. We got everybody into the grid. It's a new world order. Everyone's on the grid, big time. That's what the smartphones are for. They hook you into the grid. They're the lure, like a fishing lure, that hooks the fish. So this is the thing. The fish, the lures are being thrown into the water. The fish are walking, you know, swimming around. Not walking around, but actually we're the human fish are walking around. And they aim to catch damn fish. They're really techie-billies, all these techie-billies here. They want to try to hook us humans, pull us into the grid and have a fish fry. So, yeah, it's true. So, you know, with smart fish, they stay away from those lures. They say, no, I know it, that's a lure. I'm aware of that. I've got to get in here and see if I can do this. Yeah. Yeah. It's absolutely true. They tell the other fish, no, don't bite that. That's a lure. You went and bit into the lure. Now you're hooked. And nobody says that the smartphone is an addiction, right? Also, a few do. A few wise ones do. Say, no, kids, you can't. I talked to someone today. He said, look, my kids, only 1 hour on the phone or television. That's it. Only 1 hour. Anything more, you can't play soccer team on the soccer team. Got to have good, keep your good grades up, all that stuff. So it's an incentive to play on the soccer team. It's an incentive to... Yeah, but these are old school immigrant people that haven't found out that they're probably breaking the law by, you know, they're harming their children probably, right? They don't know all the laws here yet. Ignorance is bliss. If they found out, they'd be horrified. Actually, they are finding out, and I had a talk today, and they're horrified of it. They said, what? You can't do that? Are you kidding me? I said, too many laws here. Too many laws. Commute's not that terrible. Not yet. We're on the road to Shambhala, so we better get with it. Now, really, pilgrimage is something that is the purpose of life. And we better use all our days of our lives to strengthen our pilgrimage. And that's what we're doing here. As best we can, continually engaged with whatever comes to our attention, what comes to our attention. And if we find that there's some sort of play of attention going on, and it's beyond the scope of our understanding, isn't it? How could this happen? How could these coincidences keep happening? How come? It's the play of attention. There's something behind all of that. Doing a lot of work with Nicholas Roerich paintings, putting together a collage-like effect, and taking different paintings and using masks, alpha masks, and fitting these different paintings together to come up with a new painting, so to speak. But using all elements of his paintings, and it's really quite extraordinary. And this, I'm looking right now at some mountains and some mist and clouds and stuff. It's sort of like a Nicholas Roerich painting. I've done, how many have done? Maybe like 100 of those just the last couple nights. This license plate says golden. Wow. Nice. And some of my, I put quotes on them. Very nice quotes. They're very, very surreal. Like dreamlike. With juxtapositions you don't see in this world. But in the dream world, then you can have a lake here and a mountain here, then a mountain below the lake. And you know, it doesn't have to follow the rules of nature's landscaping. And I find that very refreshing. The elements are familiar, but the way they're put together is out of this world. It's different. And of course, Nicholas Roerich went into the Himalayan mountains and areas we might say Tibet, and did a tremendous amount of travels through there and witnessed a lot of amazing events. Quite an extraordinary life he had, experiencing going where few Westerners had ever gone. Just imagine being part of that great Tibetan culture and tradition. Wow, that's a mind blower. Because there were so many, you know, miracles and amazing occurrences, the unexpected. To go into that culture like that, you have to be very prepared for that. It's quite extraordinary looking back in the past of how much more we addressed, how much more spiritually literate we were. And how much more that got into our culture and vocabulary, and how much more comfortable I felt with that. And here now I feel like a stranger in a strange land, Robert Heinlein, I believe. A really stranger in a strange land. This is a realization that's dawning upon me right now. California is a good metaphor for our mind. It's all this clouds and everything. It's just fake weather here. I mean, we know it's not really bad weather. It can't be. You know, that cloud's not going to do anything. It's not really going to rain. It's going to give way to some beautiful sunshine, no matter what it looks like. And so, yeah, the weather here always seems gentle, and any weather suggests it's not good is fake. It's fake weather. So it's like a metaphor for the mind. We know all this trouble we're having here, difficulty, etc. It's not the real us, not who we are. And we're just faking all this trouble. Fake weather, fake bad weather. Supposed to rain today, didn't rain it at all. Lots of clouds everywhere, heavy, looking like they're going to rain, and now they don't. Oh boy, I'm real tired here, severely tired. Whoa, I had to stop very quickly there. This is the problem. Wow. The car's weaving through, so that was a... Got to be very careful with this stop-and-go sort of thing. You can't be feeling sleepy. Curse of humans, huh? Feeling sleepy. Why? Why do we feel sleepy? What do we need to be sleepy about? So when we're tired, like I am after a long work week and not much sleep at all these days, and what do you say? Ascension. Ascension. Yeah, right. Okay. Just one word. Ascension. And that wakes us up. And we say, okay, what do I need to do to focus on ascension? Right. Where's my attention? I put up my attention on ascension. And what kind of experiences do I need to prepare for that? So, everything we try to do is preparation. In some way, you know, we don't worry too much about, well, exactly what's going to happen. Don't know. But it's better to be in ascensional shape than not. Okay? Hedge your bets here in this world. As I have said, things are going to go in a certain direction, and we're going to be happy that we hedged our bets. That is for sure. That will say ascension. Oh yeah, of course I can do that. Yeah, I've already prepared for that. So if we need to exercise that option, we can. And if not, for a little while, okay. That's also, if everything's fine, that's great. But at least have that option. It feels good. So again, when you're tired, distracted, what's the word? Oh, ascension. Yeah, right. Someone was talking about Venus, and they said, we're going to go live on Venus, I heard in the future. I said, there's already life on Venus. Fourth dimensional life. Absolutely there is. And we used to have Venetians come to this world, actually. And people don't realize that back in the 50s, the 60s, there was contact taking place with Venetians. This is sort of seemed to have died out. I don't know. Maybe they said, wow, I don't think we want them to know that we're here. We don't want them coming here. They wanted to at least make the effort, but they said, no. These people are a little too nuts. They value time too much. But yeah, there's a lot of different options we have. Maybe going to the fourth dimensional. Venus was one of them. Probably there's a lot of options we have if we just wake up to it. And this place seems to be the land of forgetfulness. It's like Gulliver. We go to the land, we fall asleep, and then wake up, we're tied down by the Lilliputians. Maybe I should do this. I think I will make an extra effort here. Why not? I'll make that extra effort for ascension. Why not? What do we have to lose? Right? Well, make the extra effort while I get better at it. Did my balancing exercise this morning. Did pretty well at it. I'll do some more. That's a real good test of fitness, is get on a roller of some sort and try to balance on something that rolls. And you feel there's no certainty, you just have to, little minute adjustments are necessary. Quick little minute adjustments throughout the whole body. And so if there's some area you're really out of shape in, you can't adjust properly, you'll lose your balance. So, very good test. I'm going to stop in here and get something done, and then that's it. So, having done that now, what's the word? Ascension. Ascension is the word, right? Ascension, ascension, ascension. Where do we put our attention? Ascension. There's a girl walking dogs. I mean, two, of course. I think that's almost like more often you see two dogs, duality, rather than one. It's a nice symbol for duality, isn't it? Yeah, here we got a nice gridlock situation going. And we're working around that somehow. Got to make that turn. Wow. Hectic getting home. That's really something. It's an ordeal. But we're just, we get used to it, right? And toughen up. Existence here is an ordeal. Might as well make an ordeal in the right direction rather than an ordeal in the wrong direction. It's going to be ordeal no matter what. This is what I like to emphasize. No matter what, being here is going to be an ordeal. So what's wrong with being right? What's wrong with going in the right direction? Might as well. Sure, it's an ordeal, but might as well. The other's going to be an ordeal too, and we end up in a dead end. That's a double ordeal. It's either ordeal or double ordeal. Might as well just say, okay, it's going to be an ordeal, and stop hoping we can avoid the ordeal here, this misbegotten existence of our valuing of time, which is what all this is. So back out. Now, I came across a very interesting situation today where someone backed up two dogs. Okay, here we go again. Wow, maybe I should start keeping count. It's already three in a row, it's two dogs. And someone backed into the parking space, backed into it. I've been thinking of doing that recently too. I said, why don't I back into it? And then coming out of it, you're going forward. So you might say we backed into time, into valuing time. We backed into valuing time. And so now we're just put it in forward and go forward out of time. Out of valuing time. So it makes it sound a lot easier, right? And look at it that way, it seems a lot easier. Okay. And for now, the ordeal is over. The trip is over. And what's the word? Ascension. All right, it's a Monday. It's a work day. And we're rolling along here. It's a little noisy. I understand that. Do the best that we can. We put up a 3 hour, 20 minute video, which is just one of my best efforts for sure. A gold mine of very helpful information. I put that up, I believe, Sunday. Very cold day around the bay here. And thinking I'd have great progress from that, well, I had a great dream, but a greatly disturbing dream, actually. Got into a very bad argument. I couldn't take it anymore. I could not take the triviality, the whimsicality of this world. It's just too much. But I got very upset, but in doing so, I came across something. I said, wait a minute. It was like, depicted like going into a neighbor's yard. And then I suddenly said, wait a minute. What I saw in the neighbor's yard was that the neighbor had encroached upon our property. It was building, 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 and putting locks and gates. I said, hey, wait a minute. You know, that's our house. That's our yard. You're totally taking it over. I saw this in the dream. And this is what I've been saying in so many videos, right? We have a very severe problem here. And it was very nasty. The building that they had all this heavy black angle iron on the steps that was loose, and they kept moving it. It was dramatic, very dramatic. And this reinforced just how bad this situation is here in this world. And basically, a coup could take place anytime here. We are really set up for a spiritual coup to take place, where they just say, hey, you know, what are you doing in our house? This is our house. You know, they've encroached upon us so bad, they make it seem like you're the squatter. You're the squatter. What are you doing here squatting in our house? So this was very strong confirmation of everything that I've been saying. Now, so in this situation that we're in now, it is, it's a truck there, Indigo, it says. Interesting. The Indigo children are here telling us everything's all right, don't worry, it's all under control. Some of them are. Right. Wow. Don't worry, we'll spiritualize it all for you. Of course, that is not the teachings of the true teachers at all. No, it isn't. So this coup could take place anytime. Under these circumstances, hedge your bets. Hedge your bets. I could have been a super gambler, actually. Absolutely. I was very tempted to go into a life of being a professional gambler. Yeah, I could have been just fabulous at it, but it's too slimy and dangerous. And the associations you have, I would have been so good, I would have gotten in big trouble, probably would have been killed. You know, because, you know, you step on the wrong toes if you're too good at it. You know, there's people, the speculation of this world, that we have to understand that great many people, super wealthy people, you get super wealth by speculation in this world. And which means the whole world has to be set up in a certain way. So that contestment can take place, speculation can take place. It's done in all the markets, the financial markets, the whole world is set up this way for speculators. They've rigged it this way. And it's, you know, it's great for them because there's certain people who are expert at this and they just make a killing off of it. Now I realize I could be one of those people, no doubt about it. But I didn't want to be. I had something more important. I wanted to know the truth. I wanted to know the truth. I wanted to help people. I wanted to know the truth about this situation here. And that saved me because I had a higher purpose, something I really wanted more than wealth and fame and power. You know, I already had those in previous lives. And so I said, that doesn't really get me what I really want. So I was tempted, but then I crushed that. I just said no, turned away from it, never looked back. But this world definitely, we call the one percenters, they're wealthy due to speculation in a lot of different ways. They don't want that to change. They want to make it permanent. They want the system that benefits them. They think that this is the only way they can ever pursue happiness, that this is just the way that it is. It's intended to be this way, and they intend to keep it this way. To do so, they need to produce a lot of confusion. Now, it goes deeper than just this one percenters. This is just an example. It goes way deeper than that. But this is how it is playing out here. Is they need us to be very confused between whimsicality and reason. The purpose of whimsicality is to just keep us confused. So we don't see that it is whimsicality. We don't see the difference between that and reason. It's cloudy. We're not sure. We're confused about it. We can't make a clear decision. This is what whimsicality does. And, of course, whimsicality is based on the belief that reality is being contested. So we think that having contestment taking place is the natural order. This is natural. Like we look at nature and all the struggle for survival. We think, oh, that's just reality. No, it's not. It's a whimsical dream. But there are those who've gotten so addicted to this whimsical dream that they're terrified to wake up from the dream. And so they put their efforts into speculation and becoming great speculators. And they feel that this is like all they can do. This is the best that's possible they can do. So they feel it's that or nothing. So they certainly don't want anyone to be aware of cut and dried, black and white, very strong contrast between truth and lies, between reason and whimsicality. Because reason will tell us, this is all a dream. There is no contestment taking place at all, and then you just lose interest in that. And then people, and they're afraid that everyone will lose interest in that and say, I don't need this world at all. And then who will they make money off of, right? Unless they have all these stupid people, you know, playing the game. That then they're just cleaning up. Like, for instance, casinos, they get a percentage of all this, like sports betting, they get a percentage of everything, these bets. Doesn't matter what side you're on. They just set a line and then get a percentage of all the bets made. So it works great for them in terms of making money. But they're promoting a world that's obsessed with contestment in every which way. Obsessed with speculating, obsessed with gambling. And buying into this, that this is what reality is really about. And you need to be a winner. So, like I said, I could have been one of those speculators, but I decided not to. And so I say, with that capability that I have, still have it, stronger than ever, really, is to hedge your bets about the future of this world. Hedge your bets. Don't trust in the yoga girls, as I label it. This is a very, 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 very bad problem here. And I've tried to get people to hedge their bets here. Don't trust that this world is giving us the truth about itself. Don't believe that this world is reality. At least don't put all your bets on that. Don't put all your bets on sensory perception. Don't put all your bets on smartness. Don't put all your bets on academia. Don't put all your bets on technology. Don't put all your bets that the yoga girls will lead us in the right direction. Put some of your effort, your bets, meaning time and effort and concentration and study and determination, really determination is the word. Put that on every day trying to establish a new normal for your awareness and clarity about the real purpose of this world. And just keep trying to establish every day a new normal. Don't go to bed until you feel you've established a new normal. Your bets. This is just very wise advice. Because I could tell you, just like I used to, I could tell people what's going to happen in a baseball game. It was amazing. I could listen to a baseball game on the radio, and I could tell you what the final score was going to be, who would hit the home runs. I could basically tell you the game before it even happened. Somehow, I just had that ability. That's how good I was at it. And of course, the mind is all one, so it's really mental. Baseball games are totally mental, really, 100%. And so I was aware that everything is mental. So I just look at the minds, the mind patterns of the players and the game and everything, and I would just know, just be aware of what's going to happen, who's going to win, what's like that. It was easy. And so you could look at the world and the trends and the mental intentions that are present here, that are playing out here. It's all a play of mental intentions. And you can have a very good idea of what's going to happen. And then place your determination accordingly. Some people are determined to trust the future here. Trust how it plays out and say it's going to be great, everything's fine, no problem. Others trust in ascension. They trust what the mind has, what they've seen, what the mind has shown them. They trust like, wow, the trends here in this world are to try and really trap us very badly and throw us to the wolves. I mean, it's not, they're not, the trends are not good here. So then you would say, okay, let me use my determination in this way. So I get a set of skills. Now, if we feel that there's a very strong possibility that there's going to be troubles here, then wouldn't we get a skill set that was able to deal with those troubles and also help others? Most of us would. And so if you have a pretty good idea of what the future is going to be like, then you would work towards developing a skill set to deal with that. And that's all I've done. I have a very good idea of what the future holds. And so I've worked on a skill set to help out. So I can thrive and I can help others thrive. But since whimsicality keeps everyone confused, that's its purpose, and distracted, most people here don't really know what's going to happen. Oh, just no idea. So they think anybody who is trying to develop a skill set, they say, what are you doing that for? It doesn't make any sense. Well, there's going to be troubles. What? No, I don't think so like that. No. So it's difficult to keep your determination going. Very difficult. the world thinks you're just wasting your time. And I'm saying, no, I'm developing a skill set to deal with what I believe are going to be the trends that arise in this world. And one of the skills is ascension. That is absolutely a skill. Understanding how to ascend. How to sidestep a world. Isn't that a very handy skill to have? If a world goes like into a extreme confusion mode, if you could just sidestep that world, go somewhere else, isn't that a very nice skill set to have? If you can tell people, look, it's too much trouble. Don't struggle with it at this point. You'll be able to deal with this in another life down the road once you get the right skill set to deal with it. But since you don't have the skill set right now, it's too much trouble. Too much trouble. So don't struggle with it. So this is how I've tried to, Holy Spirit has taught me to detach from the world. Don't try to struggle with it. Don't try to solve the problems. It's going in the trends of too much trouble. We don't have the skill set yet to deal with that. And again, I want to have to keep emphasizing that our neighbors have encroached upon this world. They've taken it over, basically. And we don't have the skill set to deal with that right now because they're different. But we can get a skill set that can handle it. Ultimately, certainly we can. I'm sure of this. But right now, we don't have that skill set. And the encroachment is so severe, and the troubles we're having are so severe, and the trends are so severe, that we're going to be just buried. So instead of feeling ashamed of that, say, oh gosh, I gotta stay here and struggle, I gotta show that I'm smart. No. It's the unfamiliar, it's the unexpected, it's the play of whimsicality is playing in such a way that it's confusing us too much trouble. And so we say, well, you know what? I'm gonna just sidestep this, take a vacation, ascend. And when I get the right skill set, when I have the right skill set, and I'm trusting in the spiritual teachers saying that we certainly will, then if I need to be, I can deal with these troubles, okay? And we think, no, we got to protect planet Earth. Ah, there are many, many dwelling places, as Jesus told us, many, 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 very, very much better than this world. We do not have to be some kind of hero of this world and say, no, we got to, this is my only world, this is my... No, it's kind of like you're in a hotel room and a bunch of rowdy criminals come in and, you know, they ruin the experience for you. You can't sleep. You're getting sick, and you don't know how to talk with them. They don't respond to anything you say. You just don't know. They don't seem rational. They seem whimsical, and it's just stressing you out too much. You can't deal with it. So what do? Go to another hotel. There are many hotels. If one hotel has become rancid, you go to another one for a while until the things settle down in that other one. And you can come back if you want to. If you learn how to ascend, you can certainly come back to this world. You can appear anywhere you want to appear. That's the great thing about ascension. It really frees you up. You don't have to be born to come into a world. You just appear. You don't have to go through birth, have a body like that. And the great thing about Jesus is he's already come back. He's already reappeared here. And that greatly helps us in our ascension. He's basically saying, look, you see, I did come back. I can reappear. And you will have the same capacity as I have. He assured us of this. Jesus assures us that we will have the same capacity that he has. Okay? Assures us that he will see to it that we will have that. So trust in that. Trust in that. So we can reappear. We can leave for a while and then reappear here. But you gain these skills. You can bilocate. You can do all sorts of skills when you have the right skill set, which is really in your mind, which is effortless. When you're free of effort, free of time, belief in time, then you can do all of this easily. That these great teachers have done, you will do all of that too. No doubt about it. I don't doubt that at all. And they're dedicated to making sure that we're able to do that. So we don't have to have the skill set right now. We have to just be honest about our situation, realize we're in over our heads right now with this technology that's come in the world. There is so much in the pipeline here for controlling us that we're in over our heads. Okay. But we do have at least one option that they can't control, which that which is ascension. They can't control that. Not really. So we can exercise that option, so then we're not really in over our head in terms of we can sidestep the trouble. And everything will be great for us. Because don't overvalue this world. Worlds are a dime a dozen, really. I mean, really, and we have the power to bestow realms upon ourselves instantly. I mean, there's no limit to what we can bestow. So we need not think that we're going to hunker down here and defend this world, so to speak. That's not our purpose. Ultimately, our purpose is to drop our valuing of time. So if the world serves that purpose for us, fine. But if it becomes too difficult for the world to serve that purpose for it, then the world's really not helping us. We need not value it at all. Go to a realm that does serve that purpose better. And then again, when this world calms down and people need help and you're able to have the skill set, okay, then you could reappear here. Just appear, reappear, like just like Jesus has done. Just come back to the world if you really want to help out at some point, when you can handle it properly. And you can move around, just you appear here, then you want to appear somewhere else in the world, you just appear somewhere else instantly. It's easy. I am sure it will be very easy. And I've studied this a lifetime. I've studied this. And I have faith in these teachers that they know how to do it, no question about it. And they will see to it that we know how to do it as well. And we can be very helpful, you know, as far as helping people heal from various stuff. Easy. Piece of cake. Jesus assured us that everything that he had showed us that he did, we'll be able to do that and more. But we certainly can't do that if our mind is full of confusion and we can't differentiate between truth and lies. Certainly can't do it if we're all confused in this way. It has to be very black and white. We have to be single-minded, as Jesus told us. We can't try to be served two masters. We cannot be confused of what's truth and what's a lie. Because then we'll try to serve both of them. And then we'll get really confused. And we can't help others out in this kind of confused state of mind. We'll easily be dragged into worshiping whimsicality and delay. So we have to be very careful not to get caught up in a situation of severe confusion. I don't know if this was the right. I think I may have made a wrong turn here. There's no sign. I think it was a wrong turn. Yeah. Okay. Well, I get to see these buildings here then. This area. That's just fine. This. It looks like I'm in the boondocks here. Wow. It is indeed. Okay. Very good. Short little detour there, and I'm going to go back on track. You could look at this world. It's just a short little detour like that. Just a wrong turn that we made. Whimsicality is all it is. All based on whimsicality. It really is. And you cannot explain. How can you explain whimsicality to those who are whimsical? How can that be explained? I think this might be it. Yeah, my eyes are not so great, but yeah, okay. You cannot. It goes in one ear, not the other. There's no context. There's no stable context in whimsicality. Whimsicality says, well, any premise could be true. You know, whatever, I can change it. It would just, whatever I feel like. Okay, this is true. Okay. Ah, I go right past the building, Ascend. The name of the company is Ascend. Wow. Wow. Okay, I think I just missed, let me see. Now that's extraordinary. I'll tell you what else is extraordinary. This is D, I missed the turn. Okay, no, I'm not familiar with this area so much. Okay, everything is good. Is that twice I pulled a ticket, two times in a row, number 55. The odds on that are extraordinary, right, against that. And 55 is my number, which indicates where I need to go, what I need to do. Wow. I was asking for a sign. Give me a sign that this is all going in the right direction. That was a sign that I need to go somewhere and start working on this skill set very intensely. Super important to work on this skill set. So hopefully I can do that and work on a skill set so I can help out. Because people are going to feel like, hey, we need help. This is really terrible what's going on here. Can you help us out? All right, I don't know exactly. I'm going to have to see what I can do here. One moment. Okay, just had a very interesting series of events take place. I found the place. The proprietor of the place is very high level awareness, very unusual person. It's a woman. Looks like an Inca or Mayan or something. I don't know. Different look. Very bright, high awareness level. Very positive kind of sparkle of awareness there. And then I'm thinking, you know, I'm driving and this lunatic tries to push into my lane. They suddenly realize that it's just horrible driving on their part. They were blocked by this concrete island. They're supposed to be turning left. They said, oh no, I don't want to turn here. And so they just said, okay, let me just... They were going to hit the concrete island. I had to stop and let them in. Otherwise, they were going to hit it. You know? Accident. It was crazy. So I decided, I had to slam on the brakes, let them in. The car behind me, of course, almost hit me. Wow. Kind of interesting, right? Encroachment. We were talking about encroachment, how our neighbors, so to speak, neighbors, are encroaching upon us. There's a great example. I didn't see who it was that did this. It was in the car. It was a white Mercedes. But that was just extremely... And then they continued down the road to try to force their way in. They still didn't know where they were going. And so they did it to some other cars. Like, oh, I got to cut across here. Oh, this is where I want to go. Let me just cut across. You know, if you make a mistake, sidestep the problem. If you're in the wrong lane, turn and make a U-turn. This is what I'm hearing this driving. The people, they don't do that. Especially the Asians from like China, they don't want to admit they made a mistake. Or I don't know what could be other countries from that area too. They don't say, oh, okay, I made a mistake. No, oh, I missed it. I can't miss it. So let me just endanger everybody else's lives, like that. They don't want to admit they made a mistake. For me here, you say, oh, I got the wrong, like just like I missed I was looking for a business. I said, oh, I took a wrong turn. Okay, that's cool. Let's see where this goes. Let me turn this into a positive. So, okay, nice. I get to see these buildings I haven't seen before. Wonderful. You stay in that mode. You don't just force your way back into traffic so you can save your face. I think they had this Korean jet that crashed at SFO. They basically determined that, the problem was that is that these pilots, they wanted to save face, and they said, I can't, you know, say that I can't go against protocol, I can't do this. It's the culture. And you can't drive that way. It's very dangerous. You're going to make mistakes when you drive. You just have to realize that. I've made a number of mistakes. Of course you're going to make mistakes, especially when you don't know where you're going. Like, am I looking for this business? I don't know where it was. Said, well, maybe this is the wrong road. Okay, it's fine. Let's just enjoy our surroundings and remain at peace. They don't do that. This is the attitude, isn't it? That is very troublesome here in this world. Too much trouble. Now, we're told to use every situation as the grace of God. Look at it in a way to get lemons and make lemonade. Say, oh, thank you. So I had this terrible driver virtually cause an accident. It was just my awareness that prevented it. So I'm driving back, and I'm thinking, am I angry? No, I'm okay, peaceful, calm. Even if I'm adamant, I'm not angry at them. I just say, wow, you know, wow, this is a wow. Like, wow, they need to learn how to drive here. It's important. So I said, hey, I wonder what that was about. And they ended up pulling into this shopping center, ultimately. Like, they had to get over there. It's really important. That's why they're trying to cut over there in the first place. I said, I wonder if this has some message for me, that I need to go in that shopping center. And then I thought, wow, I'm very exhausted. Terribly exhausted, because I didn't sleep last night. I had a terrible dream, and only a couple hours of sleep. I've been going just on fumes, but I feel like I could potentially have a sudden drop, you know, the energy just boom, very possible. I said, well, I don't want to risk that. I could feel it. It's there. The exhaustion is there. It could hit at any moment. I just suddenly feel super drowsy. I got a long drive here. So I said, I'm not going to chance it. Not going to chance it. So I got one of those Starbucks drinks, double shot with protein, double shot, whatever, espresso, or what does it say? It says double shot coffee. It just says Starbucks double shot coffee and protein. Just double shot coffee and protein, whatever that is. I've used it before. It's not actually that strong. It's not that strong. And I don't have very bad effects. So I said, I'm not going to take a chance. Driving in the Bay Area is very dangerous and difficult. You don't know what you're going to get. You really don't. And it's almost guaranteed that you will be faced with split-second decisions. And you cannot be drowsy when you're doing this. So I said, I'm not going to even risk it. Discretion is the better part of valor. Now, people may say, well, you're going against your own advice, no caffeine, etc. Right, but my advice is not that of a dictator or an ideologue, okay? So when I say boycott stuff, I mean you do it within the realm of pragmatism as best you can. And if there is some emergency, then you be pragmatic in that way. So I said, I am not going to risk it. Like that. I feel perfectly okay with that. And in the past, I would have said, no, let me try. I can try. But it's just too risky. It's too risky. So you get these instances that I'm realizing more and more and more. Safe harbor don't risk. And this is just maturity, you know, it's like overall spiritual maturity. As we understand what the goal is really just seeing that reality is uncontestable. That's it. And this really just takes a little bit of will, just a little shift of willingness. And that's all that it takes. And that's the sum total of everything we really need to do. Ultimately, right? Now, ascension is just something that will facilitate this. If it comes to that here. If it comes to it. The Christian eschatology teaches it will come to that. And I haven't seen anything that counterindicates that eschatology of Christianity. I'm not wedded to it. You know, I just look at the facts. Just a pragmatist here. And again, nothing to counterindicate. It's going very much like the Bible indicates it. It will go. Very much. And for me, I say Jesus has already returned. Already returned. That's what in the dream, he declared that. And I saw him declare it to the world, to everyone here. He said, I'm back. Plain and simple. I am back. So it is going the way we were taught it would go and the way we're told to prepare. Have faith that you need to prepare for some sort of ascension. So let's hedge our bets and do it. Let's do it. What do we got to lose? We're headed towards recognition of the incontestability of reality anyway. I mean, this just helps us get there quicker. So, I mean, it's just, it's a win-win-win. You can't lose in this way. It just makes you go faster, is all. And you might say, well, I'm not really enjoying the whimsicality of this world, trying to, you know, do stuff in this world. Well, you know, if you've been here enough lifetimes, that's not a big deal. Sure, maybe I'd like to travel here and there, but not really. I don't feel deprived, you know, by not living the life of Riley in terms of traveling around and doing all this stuff. I don't feel that. I feel I'm getting more value by focusing on ascension and enlightenment. I get more value, way more value than traveling around. So I don't feel envious of those who travel. I don't. I say good for them. You know, they're getting it out of their system. Better now than later, you know, get it done. But for me, no, just stay focused on abidance, really. Abidance is the key. You get the glimpses and you realize I can do it. And then you say, wow, but I want to abide in it. And maybe ascension will be very helpful for abidance. I know the goal is reachable. I know it's easy. It's just a little shift in willingness is all it takes. That's it. And then abidance is the issue that I've been working on. And it may be that we need to ascend in order to work on abidance. That's a possibility. You know, it really is. The way the world is going, it may become very, very prohibitively difficult here to abide. We might be able to get little glimpses, but maybe that's it. The culture will just prohibit abidance. At least, you know, just be ferociously discouraging of it, condemning of it. Very likely. And they'll say, "Well, we have such a wonderful substitute. You don't need that. You're trying to reject us by not accepting our substitute." Like as if whimsicality says, "Oh, I got such a great alternative to reality." Oh, you're rejecting whimsicality. How awful! How rude! You know that. Rejecting me. Rejecting whimsicality. What is there to reject? There's nothing really there to reject, is there? Whimsicality is just a rejection of reality, which is what? Nothing. There's no alternative to reality. So how can we reject reality? There's no alternative to it. It's ridiculous. It's whimsical. It's absurd. It's an absurdity. Oh, you're rejecting absurdity. That's so terrible of you. Awful person rejecting absurdity. This is what we live with here. So, boy, really rough times now. Making a big push, and it's all on the line right now. I mean, everything I'm saying is very valid, but will the world accept it? No. Who in the world will accept this kind of talk, really? Who can accept it? And yet it's right on the mark. Now, the Tibetans culture really has been heavily steeped in spiritual, in ascension, truth and practice and all of this. It's heavily steeped in it. I mean, a lot of Tibetans, when the body died, they certainly ascended to pure lands. Longchenpa himself said, I'm going to the death-free realm when I die. This is great. Well, we don't even have to die to ascend, actually. And we have the hindsight to see that. But you know, there are all sorts of miracles in Tibetan culture and history as far as appearing, bilocating, just traveling instantly, you know, all these various spiritual miracles type of functioning, supernatural functioning. That's well known there, well known and accepted. But not in this culture. So we probably had better go somewhere else to really get all these capacities acceptable to ourselves to help out, because even though the people right now in the world are singing this very nasty tune of rejecting truth, they'll be singing a different tune pretty soon, and we had better be there with compassion and effectiveness. What is more compassionate than to develop an effective skill set? Isn't that actually compassion? What good is it if you come back to the world and say, or if you're in this world and everyone's suffering, you go, I'm so sad, it's so awful, you're suffering. I don't know what to do about it. I can't really help you, but I could just, you know, sit here and commiserate with you. I mean, is that really compassion? I mean, it might be a very weak type of compassion. But compare the two. Someone who has no skill set, can't help at all, just says, oh, you're dying, well, it's awful, I know, it's so terrible, I'm so confused, I just wish it was different, but nothing I can do about it. And or somebody else that says, look, I know exactly what to do about it, okay, we're going to do this, I'm able to help you here in this way, I can get you out of this, you know, I know these options, I know how to deal with this, no worries, we're here to help, and we're not bothered by this, we're not pulled down by it. They have a skill set to deal with it because they had the foresight and the determination to get this skill set is another way to put it, right? Good way to put it. Which is more compassionate? Okay, so this is a rhetorical question because it's obvious, black and white. There's no wiggle room about it whatsoever, is there? So when you put it in these parameters, which is the right way to put it, then we kind of wake up a little bit and say, wow, I hadn't thought about that before. Wow, it's a no-brainer. Develop the skill set. And the skill set that will be needed in this world, in the future, is a very advanced skill set. If you want to be helpful, effectively helpful, you may need to move around fast and do stuff fast. And you might need to be a couple thousand miles away right now. Boom, you're there, like that. You may need to temporarily heal a lot of people quickly, at least push it into the future, so to speak, future life. Let's deal with that in future life. You have to know healing, boom, like that. There can be no wishy-washiness about it. Now, you have to have a very adamant, decisive skill set to deal with a great deal of trouble. And this is compassion. So we're just on a path of compassion here. Real, real strong compassion. And even if things just continue like they are now, which is highly unlikely because it's things usually get better or they get worse. Everyone is still suffering terribly here. I run into people constantly. It's just crisis. Everyone's in a crisis. So it'd be great to have an advanced skill set. I call upon all those with advanced skill sets to show them to us. Come on, right now, appear. If you can appear. I'll applaud you. I say thank you. That's compassion. I'll train for that too. And I'm very convinced that there is a training for this, and it's not some super difficult training in terms of, you know, esoteric. It's just that you realize that reality is uncontestable. That's the fundamental realization, and abide in that realization. And then there's a van right there. Grace. I said, if you have the skill set, show up. And this big bus shows up, and the name of the bus is on it, big letters, Grace. That's awesome. Absolutely awesome. Wow. Healthcare. Yeah, wow. So that StarCraft, the vehicle is made by StarCraft. Grace, StarCraft. That is synchronicity right there, isn't it? Amazing stuff. The Holy Spirit's got a great sense of humor. I just wish it would, you know, give us even more here. It will. All right, people are a little jittery here driving in terms of, you know, everyone's looking for the edge. You got to find that edge. Got to find that angle. Got to save that time. Okay, that was a call from that lady I was telling you about, who I said had she's blessed with some kind of high awareness, and she already fixed. We took someone to be fixed, and I thought it'd be a big problem. She says, I found the problem. Just a little wire. It's fixed. No problem whatsoever. Boom. Everything's done. Wow. That's a sight of somebody that's just, right? I mean, high awareness. I'm aware of it. There's some kind of high awareness there. And there's just an indication of just a little problem. It's already fixed. Just a little problem. I found it right away. And it hardly cost anything. That's amazing. Wonderful. So we're talking about compassion and developing a skill set that can help others when they're really in trouble. I mean, we're headed for such trouble that we're in over our heads. We don't understand it. These our neighbors of ours they like to throw their weight around, okay? They really do. That's their specialty. And we're like, what? You know, we can't deal with it well. So you got to know how to counter that properly. And you cannot get caught up in their little silly games. All right? And their little silly competitions and the egoicness of it all. Cannot. And you have to have these skill sets that are based on grace of God and truth. Now, these Tibetans, they have a great history of that. So Longchenpa, for example, is part of that great, great heritage of very ultimately apex yoga, advanced, super advanced awareness in Tibet. He's like, up at the top of it, the very tippy top echelon of it all. So he's a good teacher to have. You know, he's a very good teacher to have. We're very fortunate that he is on the ball, on Johnny on the spot right now. Along with Jesus and I don't know what else, but he's definitely a Johnny on the spot here. And he's got his sleeves rolled up and he says, I'm ready to roll here. You know, I don't know what to say. Oh, we're ready to roll with them too. Let's go. When he first offered me, you know, he said, "Would you like to work with me? You know, work for me, work with me?" And I didn't know what to say. I didn't know who he was. I didn't know anything. I just knew he spoke in a way I've never heard anyone speak before. I didn't know what to say at all. I said, who is this? But intuitively I said, I'm interested in this. It's really very compelling. I'm attracted to this, but I don't know where this attraction is coming from. I mean, I don't know the context of any of this. So I said, I'll think about it. I'll consider it. Well, I've considered it. And I said, let's go. Let's roll up our sleeves here. Get to work. Let's get that skill set here. So, you know, I'm all in. Certainly, a Longchampa, you can trust him in terms of skill set. He is going to know what it's all about. Good Lord, you know, this is someone who's, you know, extraordinarily tuned into it all. And you know, it's such great good fortune for us. I hardly know what to say. That someone of his stature would come back here at this time to help us. And have the, you know, clarity to recognize somebody who's not even part of the tradition he was part of at all, who's coming at it from a different angle, to see, hey, but I made the call, you know, and he heard the call. So they listen for the clarity and purity and intent of the call. They're not listening to, well, what race is he, or gender, or age, or tradition, or anything like that. They don't listen that way. They don't see, they're not aware, that's not important. It's the purity of the call, and the intention of the call. So he responded. He said, here's real intent here, so let's get it going. And what they look for all is someone who's really determined and really works at it, and you know, is got the right stuff in that way. But what a blessing! What an unexpected blessing! Very unexpected. So I mean, I couldn't put it into context. I don't know who is this guy that talks in such an amazing way, that sounds so extraordinarily spiritual and so wonderfully direct, and I just don't know, you know, what this is, you know, outside. I'm not familiar with this. It's hard to commit immediately. I couldn't commit immediately. I said, I'll talk it over. Let me think about this. But I'll let you know. I'm sort of leaning this way. Yeah. But so that was several years ago. More than that. No, that was actually maybe 4 or 5 years ago. And then finally he showed up about, you know, two years ago, November 2nd, 2013? So, we're in good hands with that, with Jesus, with Longchampa, with Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, with Ram Maharshi. Any of those teachers, were in really good hands, very good hands. Whoever happens to be working with us directly, you know, right at this moment directly, you can't go wrong with those teachers. They will develop the right skill set. They will develop the right skill set. Help us develop that. They're not saying, I want to be greater than you, so I don't want you to have the same skill set as me. You know, no. They're not on some spiritual ego trip where they're saying, well, I'm the greatest, highest God, and none of you can reach that heights that I've reached, but, you know, I'll show you some things, but, you know, there's no way you can do it. They'll say, look, everything I do, you can do too, and you will do it. Maybe not right off the bat, but I will see to it all the way through and through, that you will have you know, the full recognition and familiarity with the uncontestability of reality and everything that affords us. And they'll, you know, it's like that. That's who we're well served by. And again, Jesus, great humility. All that I have done, you will do too and more. If you listen to what I had to tell you. There's no ego trip. Jesus is not on a spiritual ego trip. I have never felt in any way that he's on a spiritual ego trip. He's like the servant of all. He's here to serve. He knows the value of every single one of us in the eyes of God. And which is all is equal. We're all equally free. God doesn't have favorites. God doesn't play favorites. God gives everything to all. Everything, all to all. And Jesus knows this very well. There's no higher and lower among us all. It's all of us have all. This is reality. So there is no possibility that one of our brothers in spirit is going to be higher than us. No possibility in reality. Now, temporarily, the illusion of higherness can appear as a pragmatically, okay, but that's all it is. It's only temporary. Jesus knows this. He's not trying to extend time so he can seem to be greater than us. He's working as fast as possible to get rid of, have us drop all delay and all valuing of time so we can realize we're perfect, our perfect equality with him. He's absolutely working for that. And I absolutely support that and want that to come to fruition, immediate fruition. But he knows the way. I mean, I'm sure, like everyone else, is a little fuzzy and confused on it and uncertain about it, you know, insecure about it. But in principle, I accept it in principle. If I cannot back it up in action yet, perfectly yet, okay, it's a work in progress. But I appreciate with gratitude the attitude of these great teachers. I can relate to it, I feel it, and I accept it and with gratitude. Because it's true. It's true. Now, there may be some knuckleheads here that are heavily into delay. Some of our neighbors here. And we say, I don't want them to be equal to me. They're going to cause me trouble. No. Equal meaning perfect freedom. All having all. But all of us have all. So how can we be deprived? Nobody can. No one can be deprived. It's impossible. So it's a wonderful Alpha Pure Guru vision to have and to share it with all of us. So it's time for these way showers of compassion, those helpers that will help us develop a compassionate skill set to help others to show up now. Start showing up and say, okay, let's get going. Let's get going on this. Yeah. There's a truck that the motto is no problems ... only solutions. Wow. And there's a mountain with a sun on it. Oh my gosh, that's very symbolic. Holy cow. No problems, only solutions. This is what a great spiritual teacher would say. No, there's no problems, there's only solutions. We know we have the compassionate skill set. We have it. And they're not trying to maintain some sort of superiority over us. They will teach as much as we're capable of absorbing so that we can be as helpful as possible. So this is a great time. It's an intense time. The intensity seems to be bothering a lot of people, and I'm certainly feeling it. It's getting just too much. As we're approaching a real tidal shift, you know, there's a tide in the affairs of man, as Shakespeare said. If taken at the ebb or something, if taken at the right point, leads to success. If not, it leads into great failure. We either get better or worse. And there is a tidal shift coming up in this world. I can certainly feel this. And again, it very well, the consciousness could shift to us feeling like we're squatters here in someone else's world. And therefore, we don't really have any rights. And we got to do it their way. We're squatters. This is their attitude. Our neighbor's attitude is we are really squatters here. I'm telling you the truth. This is how they view it. This is how they feel. Why? To justify their control, of course. To justify it. This is how they view us. We're this terrible parasitic squatter race, you know, that doesn't really deserve to be here at all, but needs to be controlled, severely controlled and regulated, and all this kind of, like cattle, you know, their attitude is like that. So this attitude has crept into this world heavily, and many are already have bitten on this lure and hook, line and sinker, and feel that they need to do whatever these neighbors tell us, you know, we got to do whatever they tell us to do, that we indeed are this horrible, inferior squatter people here. Overlooking, of course, the fact that many of us throughout history have turned our attention to truth, and we have this great capacity to do so. And they have intentionally sabotaged this by distracting us, which makes it easier to justify their claim that we're squatters, right? I've always said they work to create the crisis that then they claim they're here to solve. So, oh my gosh, it's a crisis. You're really stupid squatters. We got to come in here and take over. They're the ones that have fostered this. And they claim the right hand doesn't know what the left is doing. That's whimsicality. See? Inaction. Having like a split mind, seemingly, right? Dissociation taking place there. Well, hit traffic, matter what you do, matter where you go here, you're going to run into traffic. You just cannot escape it. There's no escape. But this affords us an opportunity to do a little more taping here. So focus on ascension, and it's time now to embrace the challenge of a compassionate skill set. To embrace it. That's all. You just show up. Say, okay, I'm in. That's my feeling. I'm not thinking about, well, what am I going to do? Details. Where there's a will, there's a way. That's all you have to know. Where there's a will, there is a way. So I'm willing to do it, and so I'm not worried. We will find a way. The teachers will find a way for us. You don't think that Longchamp is going to be stumped, all right? Don't think that for one instant. Longchamp is not going to say, wow, you know, I don't know how to really help you. I mean, you got such bad problems. I can't figure it out. Is he going to say that? Not at all. I don't believe that at all. And I guess I used to be afraid of that. I always felt like, well, I don't want to bother the teachers because I mean, I don't think they can, you know, deal with my troubles. I got such bad troubles. My gosh, they can really. So I said, I don't want to waste their time. I'm a hopeless case, really. But to them, there's no such thing as a hopeless case. They could see right through and know exactly what to do. Not the slightest bit stumped by us. So they're not like saying, oh my God, here he comes. Uh-oh, here's trouble. Here comes trouble. If I'm willing, truly willing, they're not going to say, here comes trouble. They're going to say, wow, here comes willingness. I love it. This is great. Thank you. And this is the attitude they have. No matter if someone shows up, they say it's the grace of God they showed up, and they know what to say, what to do, how to help them, move towards a compassionate skill set. So where there's a will, there's a way. We don't have to know anything other than look to say, okay, I'm willing. That's it. Just work on our willingness. Feel the willingness. Feel the willingness to develop a compassionate skill set. Again, because the troubles this world is going to be facing are very, very intense. And there has to be a very advanced skill set to deal with it. Very advanced. Not just being a nice person. Okay, no. You have to be a very effective, very effective. Very reassuring. Say, don't worry. I know there are other realms, okay? I'm very familiar with these other realms. Easy to get there. Don't worry. Great place. You know, a lot of different stuff. I don't know exactly what the skill set will consist of, but I am positive that we can have a vastly more advanced skill set than we have now, not based on technology at all. The advanced skill set that the world is teaching is technology. That's ludicrous. That's baby stuff. You know, it's even worse. It's like it's a false advanced skill set, actually. Very false. So it's time for the teachers to start showing us their skill set and saying, hinting, okay, look, this is, I have a skill set like this, and we have the willingness. And, you know, it might scare some of us, say, oh my gosh, I can never do that. They expect me to do that? Are they crazy? No, I don't feel that way. Whatever they show me, I say, you know what, they will find a way for me to have that skill set because I have the willingness. I have the willingness to pay attention, and they will find a way. No doubt about it. I don't have any doubts about it. If they just suddenly appear in glorious light or something, I'll say, okay, that means that's a skill set. That's part of their skill set, and they will show me how to do that. They will make sure that I have that skill set. They will make sure of that. Wow, very dangerous to stop and go traffic. Here's a perfect example of why I need not to be drowsy. Is this? There's nothing more dangerous than this type of driving, really. It's because everybody's in a hurry. Once this traffic starts flowing, everybody starts accelerating and trying to go as fast as possible. And then it backs up, and then everybody slams on the brakes, and some people not paying attention, and suddenly, oh my gosh, they slam the brakes, and you don't see their brake lights haven't gone on. And then you have to slam your brakes on. It is just nerve-wracking. Yeah, the best way is just give a lot of space, which I'm trying to do now. But then cars, of course, cut in front of you. But, you know, everybody here is doing the best they can. They really are. I've got to praise them. And we're all under the gun right here with all of this, really. And I think people have settled down a little more because it's not quite as bad as it used to be. And they're just not quite as frantic as they used to be. They're kind of getting used to it, this terrible traffic. And they just say, oh, there's nothing we can do. So let's not push it too much. It's gotten a little better. But what else can you do, right? I mean, if you try to hit your head against it, it's not good. So traffic's now going real fast. But you got, don't count on that. Continue. You know, be alert that it might suddenly back up. Just like our neighbors may suddenly say, "Hey, guess what? You're just squatters here. You don't have any real rights. The only rights you have are the ones we give you, and you'll be happy. You'll take that and be happy about it. So we're going to take away all these various freedoms. You don't deserve those freedoms. Who do you think you are? Those sovereign freedoms are for the rulers of this planet. You're not the rulers of this planet. You don't even belong here. So, you know, that attitude can pounce on us like a ferocious beast. And it can pounce on us any moment, actually, right now, right here in this world. And there can be certain events that take place that just pull the rug right out from underneath us here. And we lose our confidence. Very, very likely this will happen. In viewing the attitude of people here, I see that they've lost the will to contest it anymore. To contest that in terms of, you know, the feeling that they have no choice but to believe in contestment, and that they've been beaten, that kind of thing, and they've lost that will, the spiritual will. It has just been undermined, and they really are just sitting ducks at this point. The attitudes of the people of the world are very much sitting ducks. Instead of just saying, oh yeah, really? Well, you know what? We'll deal with that attitude of yours in a future life. I'm not going to even deal with it right now. I'm not going to even deal with that absurdity right now. Okay, it's an absurdity. I'm not going to deal with it right now. I'm not going to pay any attention to it. But I might engage with that in a future life. Just like talking to a child, you know, they're not able to do it that way. They're too intimidated. They're saying, oh yeah, well, we're going to fight, you know. You have to just spiritually dismiss it as just utter nonsense, total nonsense. We're not giving any validity to that. We're not even entertaining it whether or not we're going to give validity to it. We're saying, we'll take that. That's, you know, it seems like that attitude's too much trouble for us. So we'll take that up at another future lifetime, but not this one. And you say, we're squatters? We'll say, well, you know, if that's your attitude, we'll go somewhere else much better than this place. If that's what you know you're crying about, it's not a problem. Yeah. You know, keep your sense of humor, your confidence. Don't be intimidated. Say, well, we got great options. Are you kidding me? We don't really like this world very much anyway. But don't accept the idea that you're some sort of squatter with no rights, no right for freedom. See, this is the problem. You think, well, I got to stay here. So, okay, so I got to battle it out. Or if I lose the battle, the contest, then I'll be defeated. I'll be enslaved. You know, don't even go there. Don't even go there. Just laugh at them. You'll go, you know, whatever. You know, it's just the play of whimsicality, the dance of continuity, fear. Dance keeps dancing. Keep on dancing. Yeah. I will just dance over here in a really, really wonderful place and let y'all get, you know, buyer's regret, and then we'll help you out and we'll do, you know, we'll have a skill, we'll work on our skill set. You say, okay, well, whatever. We'll keep working on our compassionate skill set. Just look at them and say, they need help. Okay, they need some severe help, but it's too much trouble right now for me. I gotta work on my skill set until it's, you know, enough, compassionate enough. And just, you know, just say, okay, whatever. And then just insist that you do that. That's it. And don't be derailed from that purpose at all. But how many can do that in the world? This is the question. You don't get angry, you don't get belligerent, you don't get no contest with them at all. There's no contestment. This is, I'm free to choose what I want to choose. This is what I'm choosing. All attempts to put this, insist that I'm therefore creating a contest is a case, of course, an absurdity, because reality is uncontestable. So there can't be any real contest at all. No true contestment whatsoever. So it just has to be, you know, a bogus imaginariness. Don't have to accept that at all. All right, see? Let somebody in here because I'm in a good mood. Everybody's calm. Oh, you want to get in? Get your car? Go ahead. That's fine. I can hit the brake and slow down a little bit. No problem. Most drivers these days would have sped up and blocked the driver. You know that? It's like they blocked me on the railroad tracks here. But, so we keep our poise no matter what. But this is what could easily collapse any moment in the world right now, is the jurisdictional authority can suddenly be expressed, and everyone's expected then to collapse into submission to that. And the mood and attitude and intelligence and will of the world, but the way I've assessed it, and I would say I'm very good at that, is that the world is just going to submit. They don't see any option. They really don't. They don't see the option I'm talking about. Otherwise, they'd be talking about it. It would be all over. There'd be so many people saying this and talking about it and saying, you know, they would. If they know this, they're not supposed to hide it. Be quiet about it. Hide it. No, Jesus said, no. Let people see your light. Don't hide it. Or else Jesus will say, I don't even know you, because, you know, you got to speak up. And they're just not doing it. So that means that they're intimidated. And people have tried to intimidate me a little bit. I thank them for that, because that helps me see that, you know, where I have to improve. I really do. I'm not mad at anyone. I say thank you for pressuring me that way so I can practice, you know, a skill set of not being intimidated by that. But people are getting bolder about it. Okay, I will say that. I see a definite trend of those who come to the videos and try some way to intimidate me, absolutely. Into silence, into submission. into submitting, submission to the belief I'm a squatter, you know, I got no freedom. You could say we're all squatters in this illusory, you know, dream realm, right? We're all dream squatters. So, six of one, half a dozen of another. But certainly, reality is not contestable, and that's the bottom line. And everyone must realize this. And so realize that, and then we'll see what we say. Okay, so let's talk, you know, in this universe. I say, look, let's not be at each other's throats at all. And let's first realize that reality is uncontestable, and then we'll see where we stand with one another. It's like that. So I say, that's why I say, let's push it on to the future. And if we need to engage it in all this at each other's throatness, we'll do that in a future life. Okay, but right now, let's all cool out. Let's all decommission the ego, decommission whimsicality. And if we feel we have to recommission at some point, we can do that. But let's just all chill out, have a great retirement, and realize the uncontestability of reality. And then let's see where we stand at that point. Right? Great advice. And these neighbors are capable of understanding that. I've had an instance. I remember an instance where one of our neighbors came to me in a dream, and I gave them some advice, and they said, "Huh, I like that. I'm going to consider that." I never, you know, hadn't quite seen it that way, and that's really, so, you know, they're looking for truth too. Absolutely, we all are. We just don't want to feed their insanity. That doesn't help them. Our cosmic neighbors. You know,
they don't think very highly of us, you know, and that's the, they think a little too highly of their, you know, their intellect is the problem. And their technology, their intellect, their smartness, they think way too highly of that. They're way overconfident. They've got a very severe complex. And that complex, it's hard to deal with, right? I mean, this is the complex of the world now. These people who have come into the world and those who are also our neighbors working through them and in subtle ways here, they're very overconfident. And they mistake that for some sort of inherent right to rule others and control others. And, you know, they're just way off the mark with all of that. But that overconfidence complex is intimidating. And you don't really want to oppose it all the time, because it's wearisome to keep opposing that. It just grinds on you. So, you know, we kind of just go along with it. They think, okay, we're submitting. No, 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 we're not submitting at all. We just don't want to waste our time dealing with, you know, it's too much trouble for us to try to deal with it with our skill set. We're going to acquire a higher skill set so then we can deal with it later. We're just going to sidestep it all. And of course, they haven't figured that possibility out yet. That's not in their computers. That doesn't compute with them. They think they're so smart. They say, we can't possibly sidestep them. They're way smarter than us. There's no way that can happen. So they may have to reprogram their computers after this. Which they know, like, which is a big job. They say, oh my God, what a headache, you know. I don't know how we can do this. A lot of reprogramming will be necessary. That is for sure. And they may just say, oh God, forget it. I don't know. What should we do here? We need advice. Help! It's too much. We're really stuck. This is horrible. And then, of course, we'll say, well, okay. Yeah, look, here's an alternative to reprogramming everything. And they might say, oh, wow, I'm going to take a look at this. This seems like it might be really helpful. Can we really be free of the computers and all this stuff? Yeah. Oh, wow. I like that. Yeah, absolutely. They'll be singing a different tune soon enough. Soon enough. All right, bait it home safely. And again, knowing how dangerous that rush hour traffic is, don't want to be super drowsy. Try to deal with that. It's you're running a risk. Why run a severe risk at this point? Not smart. Oh boy, very intense. So to refocus, we would say, time for the skill set that we can aim for to start showing up. To show up. And we say, okay, great. I have great faith and trust that you will know how to get me to that skill set, no doubt about it. No matter how advanced it may seem to be. You see somebody levitating, you know, it's like, okay, well, I'm sure it's quite simple and easy. And you will have if that's part of the skill set, then you will show me, you know, bring me into that skill set, no doubt about it. It's like a great hitting instructor or something, or a golf instructor. Someone says, look, I'm really willing to learn. I'm absolutely willing to learn. And I'll say, okay, great. I'll work with that willingness, and I will, you know, get you really grooved on a great swing and a great golf game. And then before you know it, you've got the game. Now, you can't be all split-minded and confused, obviously, because in whatever teacher teaches you, you'll confuse it and forget it or mix it with something else, and you say, oh, I'm not progressing, or something like that. Now, you know, that's frustrating for you, but these teachers will have a way to unravel that and move us past that. So, trust in the great teachers. They will get the job done. And what more needs to be said? Have faith in that.